The US Navy makes up a very large part of the overall US air power, contributing some 26% of the overall US combat plane numbers. But while the US Air Force is buying their F-35As in bulk and the Marine Corps is spending on F-35B, with both services on schedule to eventually replace over half of their planes with F-35s, the US Navy is lagging far, far behind when it comes to 5th generation planes. Why is that? And will it change? Stay tuned to find out. The F-35 program just keeps going, and for our channel to keep going, please allow us a minute from our sponsor. Thanks, Keeps! They're all about curtailing men's hair loss. Were your dad or grandpa almost bald when they were in their 60s? If so, your hair might be at risk too. Keeps provides an online consultation with a real doctor to recommend the right hair loss treatment plan for you. You'll get the arranged medication shipped to your doorstep every 3 months. Sure, if you're a millionaire, you can try hair transplant. That'll get some hair back. But Keeps offers affordable, FDA-approved hair loss medications. Some may help regrow some hair. Furthermore, Keeps will help slow down future hair loss. So it's important to start using it early, when your hair has only started to thin out. Did you ever wonder why I never take my hat off? Obviously, I'm hiding something. If I'd known about Keeps, maybe I could have looked like this. Prevention is key. If you're ready to take action and prevent hair loss, go to keeps.com/binkov or click the link in the video description. You'll get 50% off your first order. keeps.com/binkov. Back to our video now. Before we go into the why, let's look at the exact numbers, both current ones and planned ones. Today, the US Navy operates little under 900 combat planes. That figure includes everything from the reserve units to aggressor training units. Some 50 F-35s is of course a very small number, given that it's 2022 and other countries are procuring stealthy fighters as well. China alone currently operates easily twice as many J-20s than the US Navy has F-35Cs. It has to be said that the C variant is also procured by the US Marine Corps. They currently operate some 21 or so C variant airframes. It's been a long tradition that a few of the Marine Corps units train to operate from the US carriers. Indeed, a lot of US carriers usually have one Marine Corps squadron aboard, instead of its own Naval Aviation Squadron. But when other variants of the F-35 are explored, it becomes apparent that the C variant is getting less love. The Air Force's A variant was getting ordered the most since the inception of the whole program. The B variant, curiously, started with its purchases in 2007 alongside the A variant's first purchases. But the C variant was waited upon for a few years. Indeed, while the Marine Corps rushed ahead with declaring operational capability of its B-type way back in 2015, the US Navy was content to go slower and declare operational capability of the C-variant in 2019. One could say that the Marine Corps was in a greater rush. The B-variant is to replace not only all their Harriers, which are really substandard combat planes by today's standards, but also legacy Hornets. Those Hornets are not only getting uncompetitive capability-wise, but some are literally so old they would be unsafe to fly. The US Navy had less urgency there, as it procured hundreds of Super Hornets. Initially, it was to replace other planes, but by now pretty much all of its legacy Hornets are already retired, having been replaced by Super Hornets as well. On a few occasions, the US Navy mentioned it's fine with waiting for a more capable program submodels of the F-35. Those come in blocks, and while the early F-35s were basically just certified for AMRAAMs, the Block 3F that the US Navy wanted has a much broader range of weapons at its disposal. Part of the reason is also price. Getting those older, already built airframes modernized to later blocks costs extra money. The baseline F-35C also costs more than the simpler Air Force's A variant. The US Navy was fine waiting out for the first several years, during which F-35 costs were over $200 million per plane, and have the other services pick up the tab. Running in any production line takes time and money. The B variant is by far the costliest, but that's due to its unique short takeoff and vertical landing capabilities. There's really no going around that financially. During the last few years, the F-35C has started gaining on the B variant in the number of orders for the US military. Overall, planned numbers for the US Navy and Marine Corps services favor the B variant slightly. If the division is done by services and not the variant, then the Marine Corps is getting over 50% more F-35s. So, the US Navy can't really claim it's been waiting for the F-35 to mature. It simply didn't plan to buy many F-35s at all. But has it always been like that? Back in 1997, when the first official review of requirements was published, the Navy wanted to buy many more carrier-based JSF models. But it didn't take long for those plans to change. What happened between 1997 and 2003 was the F-35 design winning the JSF competition. The losing design was Boeing's. Since then, the plan stayed almost the same, though the US Navy did plan for 13 additional planes after a review of requirements in 2016. Other more important events happened even earlier. In 1991, the Avenger 2 program was cancelled. It was to replace all the Navy's and Marine Corps A-6 strike planes. The Navy then decided it would use the Super Hornet to replace those aircraft. In 1991, the F-14 production was stopped as well, as the type was deemed as increasingly obsolete by the Department of Defense. Its replacement, the NATF program, which would have been a naval variant of F-22 or F-23, was also cancelled around that time. So, when the Super Hornet was officially ordered in 1992, it was to replace both ground strike planes and fighter planes. There simply was no other choice. Indeed, the very initial Super Hornet plans, in the 1990s, saw requirement plans for a total of 1,000 Super Hornets. Back then, in the 1990s, the JSF program was still nascent. But the Navy was on board from the get-go, and there were plans and hopes that the initial operational capability of the F-35C might be reached in 2012. As the JSF program shaped up, those early Super Hornet plans were scaled down. But, as we know, development lasted longer. In the meantime, the US Navy was a bit short on planes, so it kept buying more Super Hornets. Though it has to be said that it wasn't always just the US Navy. During the last several years, there were occasions where the Department of Navy did not want to buy any additional Super Hornets, yet the Congress would step in and mandate further purchases. How much of that was due to political reasons is, of course, hard to say. After a few more such small top-ups in contracts, today the Super Hornet fleet reached 600 airframes. There's a fairly big contract still going on, with the first of those delivered late last year. So the overall Super Hornet fleet will number around 680 planes for the US Navy, when all is done. As the Growler variant also replaced the previous EA-6 jamming planes, the grand total is likely to end at almost 850 airframes. But it seems enough is enough. While the politicians tried to sell another 36 Super Hornets to the Navy recently managed to fight that plan off, choosing to use that money for quicker development of the 6th generation fighter from the NGAD program, which is expected to deliver first combat planes to the Navy sometime in the 2030s. So where does all that leave the F-35C? It seems to be on track, finally, after all these years, to be the only Navy's combat plane to be in production, after the last of those 78 Super Hornets rolls off the production line around 2024 or so. Its production plan seems to have solidified at around 20 or so airframes per year, which means that in the early 2030s, the F-35C will still have a few dozen airframes to be delivered. It's possible that a small number of today's Super Hornets will be replaced by the F-35Cs, though the original plan from the late 90s was to have F-35Cs replace legacy Hornets. But Super Hornets did most of that work. The F-35C will remain a small force within the US Navy, making up around 25% of the overall fleet, perhaps a bit more when the Marine Corps seaplanes are included. There were many twists and turns in the Navy's quest for stealth planes. Perhaps if it had gotten the ill-fated Avenger II in the 1990s, maybe then it would have shared the Air Force's view on the usefulness of stealth. But having no stealth planes of its own, until just several years ago, the Navy's view on stealth is perhaps not surprisingly not as supportive of it. In 2012, the Navy's Chief of Naval Operations said that improving computing technology will compromise detectability of even the most stealthy plane. In 2015, he stated that stealth may be overrated. Politically, it's not surprising that such comments would be more likely to come from a service not operating stealthy planes. as opposed to one already using many, like the Air Force. While it could be just sour grapes from the Navy, it could also signal that the Air Force is more wed to the whole idea financially, and now it can't speak as easily against it. Unlike the Air Force, the US Navy is also heavily invested in area jammer systems, like the Growler variant of the Super Hornet. Unlike the smaller tactical jammers for self-protection, which the Air Force also uses, such area jammers can disrupt enemy radars from longer distances, protecting a whole group of Navy planes at once. Stealth and jamming are not mutually exclusive, but if one is not available, it certainly helps to have the other. Having such jamming capabilities certainly does help the Navy not be very desperate for many stealthy planes. But besides stealth, what else does the F-35C bring to the Navy that the Super Hornet lacks? They're both of roughly the similar class, though F-35's stealth means it's a bit heavier. Range-wise, they're roughly comparable, though since the F-35 never had its range officially stated, some estimates may offer a slight edge there. Curiously, the Navy has opted not to pay for full development of the conformal fuel tanks for their new Super Hornets. Does that mean they're content enough with the existing range? It's hard to say. The F-35 is more limited in weapons capacity when it wants to remain stealthy, but it compares well when it's allowed to use external hardpoints as well. Super Hornet in the shown configuration also suffers from just one external fuel tank available to it. Of course, in the current iteration, the F-35 simply has better avionics. Distributed optical sensors, built-in jamming capability, somewhat more modern radar, and so on. While modernized Super Hornets could approach those capabilities, they can't fully reach them. Overall, the F-35C is a better plane for modern combat, but it's evident the Super Hornet is a known quantity to the US Navy. Their ecosystem is almost solely devised around it, as they use it for air superiority, ground strikes, electronic jamming, and in-air refueling roles. Having such a slimmed-down fleet offers great savings. And indeed, Super Hornet is still cheaper to procure and cheaper to operate. While the Navy does plan to put F-35s on every big carrier they have, to be the tip of their spear, they don't seem to be concerned that if and once those initial squadrons are lost in battle, the replacement planes will be the less potent Super Hornets. The Navy still hasn't really decided what the optimal mix of planes on their carriers should be. With everything said so far, it's clear the real issues the Navy may have with the F-35C are complex. Part of the reason may be political. Maybe Boeing simply has more clout in the Navy than Lockheed Martin does. It may also be that the C variant was simply a wrong product at the wrong time. The cost, the delays, and unforeseen competition from China may have made it into an unwise purchase. The Navy may have decided that pumping tens of billions into F-35s instead of cheaper to buy and operate F-18s is a bad bet in the interim. Sure, the F-35 is a better plane when a one-on-one comparison is made, but the overall system potency, including other support planes with everything adjusted for cost, may be such that the Navy doesn't see the F-35 as worthwhile a purchase. So the Navy may be thinking that using the Super Hornet as a stopgap measure and saving up the resources for an even more advanced NGAD plane may provide the Navy with the winning ticket long term, or that all-important potential clash in the Pacific that they may expect to occur in the next decade or two. Let's all hope it doesn't come to that.